Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Buddhang Dhammang Sanghang Namassami. I'm very happy to be here at BIA once again. I come to Thailand about twice every year and try to make myself available to offer teachings here. I'm very happy to see that BIA is continuing its good work and also at this time having these conference and the retreat and teachings in relationship to Dhamma and society, particularly in honor of Lumpur Buddhadāsa's 111th year. On June the 17th, just passed by a couple of days ago, that was the 100th anniversary of the birth of Lumpur Chah. So he was 11 years behind Lumpur Buddhadāsa. And so that this has been a time of recollection and reflection on Lumpur Chah's teachings. And next year in January they'll have a large ceremonies at his main monastery Wat Pah in honor of his 100th year after his birth. Seeing the theme of Dhamma and society, I was reminded of a talk that Lumpur Sumedho gave many years ago that had the title "The Buddhist Ideal of a Perfect Society." So I thought, well, that kind of fits very neatly, and so I thought I would use that as a theme. So I confess that I stole the title from Lumpur Sumedho. He came up with that. But I feel it's a very useful theme to reflect upon, particularly because we have an idealistic culture. Yesterday I was giving a talk at the World Fellowship of Buddhists, Posolaw, and one of the questions that somebody asked, the talk was about fear and anxiety, about worry, and one of the questions after the talk was about being idealistic. That a woman who heads up a particular organization said that many of the people that work for her, they suffer a lot because of they are very idealistic and the world is never quite perfect enough. As they worry about all the things that are wrong with the world. And so they're good-hearted people, but their good-heartedness is a cause for suffering. She said, the other half of the people who work for me, they're kind of chui-chui. They say, "Mai pen rai." Never mind, yeah, everything's okay. And they are a bit too relaxed. So she was asking about how to find the middle way for the ones who are too idealistic and worry too much and the ones who are too easygoing, too chui-chui or lazy, kikia. So maybe we'll get onto that later on this evening. So when I was reflecting about this teaching of Lumpur Sumedho's that he gave many years ago, of course, in the very first sentence that he utters, the first words he speaks, he says, really, there isn't any such thing as a perfect society. So he kind of unplugs that idea from the beginning. We are able in the human realm to imagine. We can create an image in our minds of how things should be or could be, and so we can do that. But I was saying yesterday, about the talk yesterday, and the answer I gave to this woman about her workers who are too idealistic. If the mind attaches to idealism, like in a perfect world it will be like this. If everyone was good and kind and unselfish, the world would be like this. Yeah, if we attach too strongly, if we cling to an ideal, then it can make us suffer, and the world is never good enough. I'm never good enough. Others are never good enough. The government is never good enough. My family is never good enough. Nothing is ever really as it should be. So then our own kindness, our own good-heartedness becomes a cause for suffering. So then we might take the opposite approach and say, well, therefore all ideals are a waste of time, they're useless. So why would we create an ideal, or why would we hold up a model or a standard if it's just going to make us suffer and make us feel like we're not good enough, we're not trying hard enough, why bother? So it's important to reflect on why would we have an ideal society? Why would we have such models, or why would the Buddha give teachings about how to live skillfully as a person, how to live skillfully in a group, how to skillfully lead a group of people? You know, why would he lay out these models of perfection if they're not useful? So this is something that's important to consider. So we have a very good example. We have the Prapotaru. Yeah, is a doya. It's an example. It's an ideal. You know that I can safely say that the Buddha image will never have a problem with aching knees. Never has to eat. Never gets tired. Doesn't even have to breathe. And like when the Buddha was very old, when he was 80 years old, he said he had chronic pain. His back was always hurting him. In many of the sutta teachings the Buddha describes, he says, Sariputta, my back is hurting me. The assembly is still awake. I'm going to go and rest my back. You carry on giving another Dhamma talk because everyone is still awake. So at the beginning of the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, the Buddha's account of his own last days, he says, I'm an old man now. I'm 80 years old. My body's like an old cart, held together with strings and straps. He says, the only way I can feel comfort is to absorb my mind into emptiness, into the sunyata vihara. Only by completely disengaging his mind from sight, sound, smell, taste, touch and feeling could he experience any kind of comfort. Which means while he was seeing people and walking around and engaging, he was in pain all the time. So even the Buddha had chronic pain. The Buddha image does not have chronic pain because it's a duayan, it's an example, it's an ideal. So, but does that mean we don't bother having them? Do we throw out all the Buddha images? No, because the Buddha image is, presents to us an inspiring form. The body sitting upright, the face calm, the eyes open, alert. And this combination of qualities of paying attention, of being being calm, being peaceful, being wise, those are represented. They are qualities that a Buddha image is designed to encourage within us. So when we see a Buddha image, it makes us feel peaceful. When we see a Buddha image, it encourages us to wake up. When we see a Buddha image, it encourages us to let go of our arguments and our, criticism, complaining about the world, because it also encourages a quality of peace and patience. So this is one of the reasons why an ideal can be useful. If you attach to the Buddha image and say, you know, this is mine, or this is more beautiful than that one, or I've got the most valuable and holy Buddha image in the whole of Bangkok, then you're not using the image for the purpose for which it is intended. It's being used as an object of attachment. So if we are able instead to take an ideal and then use it, then that helps us to bring out the best in ourselves, as we say in English. So, also, I always like to teach at BIA because they let me talk in English here. Because my English is 1,000% better than my Thai. So, but if people don't understand anything that I say, then when we have the time for questions and answers, santanatam, then we can clarify some of the things that I've been saying. Now, when we see a Buddha image, then, as I said, it encourages those qualities. It helps us to bring out the best in ourselves. And this is a very important principle that the Buddha used very directly. There's a teaching he gave that's called the Upozata Sutta. Upozata, like Ubozo, about the moonday observance. And it's describing the Buddha's own thinking about how he created the form of the eight precepts, Sinpan. And so it's interesting because it's just recounting his own thinking. It's not really talking to anyone else, it's just his own consideration internally. And so why he created the eight precepts, it was because he thought, well, on these moon days, every 7 or 8 days, they have a different phase of the moon. Different groups gather together and they have observances for their own religious teacher, their own religious practice. So I want to create a form that is beneficial for the lay people, lay community, so they can gather on the moon days, well, once a week, and it can be a time that is beneficial and helpful to them in many ways. So then his thinking went, he said, all their lives from the time of enlightenment until they pass away, an arahant never deliberately takes the life of another living being. They cannot. And so wouldn't it be a good thing for the lay community to adopt this same action, this way of being, to deliberately not take the life of another living being, because in that way they will be living as the arahants do. They'll be copying the behavior of the arahant, and that will be for their long-lasting welfare and happiness. And so with the other eight precepts, all their lives from the time of enlightenment till they pass away, an arahant does not take what is not given. They don't engage in sexual activity. They can't lie. They never say anything that's untrue. They don't use intoxicants or ways of distracting the mind. The arahants, they only eat in the morning, in the one part of the day. They don't seek to entertain themselves or decorate themselves. They don't use jewelry, or they don't listen to music, or go dancing, or playing games in the park. They're not interested in that. That has no meaning or value for them. And then all their lives, until from the enlightenment until the end of their life, an arahant always chooses to have a simple, low sleeping place. They don't indulge overindulge in sleep. And wouldn't it be a good thing for the lay community, as with all these, if they act in that way they will be acting as the arahants do, and that will be for their long-lasting welfare and happiness. So when you sit like a Buddha, it helps you to be more like a Buddha. If you sit kind of in a super sloppy way, it makes you more sloppy, kikir. But if you're kind of too tight, that's not like a Buddha. That's just like someone who's overstressed, trying too hard. But the Buddha is upright, but relaxed, peaceful, energetic, and totally at ease, both at the same time. Awake, paying attention to the world, but not attached to the world. So, and this is why an ideal can be useful. That, like in the Upozita Sutta, the Buddha is spelling out, if we take this model of the behavior of the arahant, and we act in that way, that helps us to recognize within ourselves. You choose to not kill anything, it helps you to remember, to recognize in your own heart, that in you which is not capable of violence, that which does not want to hurt, cannot hurt another being. It reminds you, oh yeah, there's part of me that never wants to hurt another being. All right. There's part of me that is honest, that doesn't want to tell a lie, that knows lying is really uncomfortable, painful, difficult, creates all kinds of problems. So it's, oh yeah, there's part of me that wants to be completely honest. All right. So you're feeding those particular aspects of your own nature. So when we think about the standards that the Buddha offered, the kind of ideals, say, an ideal person would be like this. Then there are three different areas where the Buddha gave teachings. And these are lists of qualities, and Yeah, I brought along a crib sheet just in case I forget. So these are lists of qualities, but I don't want to just kind of make a laundry list, as they say in English, just like boop, boop, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Because when you get to about number 5, you can find that you switch off, right? So, but I thought it would be useful to share with everyone these qualities that the Buddha describes. So the three areas. The first area is of the individual action, the individual attitude. So an ideal person, how do they act? Yeah. Then the second area is in a group. Now what's the ideal way that a group functions and lives together harmoniously and for the benefit of everyone in the group? And then the third area is leadership. How does one lead a group if you're running a company, or you're the, training a group of novices, or you're the running an organization like BIA, yeah. Or you're an abbot of a monastery, or whatever, you're a prime minister, or a queen, or a king. Yeah. What are the qualities of a good leader? So the Buddha made very, very clear these ideals. Okay, a perfect person, a good person, a good leader, a group that's functioning in a wholesome way, this is how they do it. These are the qualities that are brought into being. So in a way, it's like describing, if you want to have a beautiful, inspiring Buddha image, this is how you make one. These are the proportions. You have the head like this, and the shoulders like this, and the back like this. Yeah. So the Buddha spelled that out. If you want this to work well, this is how you do it. So that he made clear what the ideals are. So the first collection of qualities in relationship to the individual, the perfect person, or the person who is a sapurisa, a good person, or one who is living in a complete way, or who's a well-rounded person. I don't know what the Thai for that would be, but someone who is complete and, well-trained in all human qualities. So that there's one particular sutta called the Sapurisa Sutta. Sa means good or true or right. Purisa means a person, like Purut. Sapurisa Sutta. He outlines 7 qualities. And in these qualities, it's interesting to note the main thing that he's talking about is, or that he focuses upon, is our ability to be observant, to notice things. And in Pali we would say to have yoniso manasikara, wise reflection, dhamma vijaya, to investigate reality. In Western psychology you'd say something like having good pattern recognition abilities, good social awareness, so that you are observant, you're watching what's happening in you, what's happening around you, and you're aware of the effect of your actions on others and how your relationships work. So that the main thing about that the Buddha focuses upon in terms of developing on being an ideal person is these qualities of having sati sampajanya, mindfulness and clear awareness, and being observant, being attentive, and being able to recognize the way that things work. So these 7 qualities are dhammanyuta, so it's the awareness of the origins of things, or the source, the causes of things, like, how did this happen? I'm here because Yong Mui sent me an invitation. Oh, I hear you're coming to Bangkok again, can you come to BIA? I'm here because I've been here before, and people have appreciated the things I had to say, so they invited me again. I'm here because Lumpur Cha had great respect for Lumpur Buddhadāsa, and the one picture on the wall at Lumpur Cha's kuti, right above his head, was a picture of Ajahn Buddhadāsa. He didn't even have a picture of Lumpur Man, but he had Lumpur Buddhadāsa sitting above his seat. So that's a message. So I said, well, if Lumpur Cha respected Lumpur Buddhadāsa so much, yeah, I'd better give these people plenty of attention. So you reflect upon the cause or the origin of things. Then the second quality is atanyuta, or looking at the results or the objectives. You consider, what's the objective? Well, the objective is to help people to understand how to use ideals and to help to convey some useful information, things that will be enable us to live our lives as students or as young adults, older people, retired people, practitioners of the Buddha's path, how to use the Buddha's teachings in a way that can really benefit our lives and help society. That's the kind of objective. So that's attanyuta, A-T-T-H. Then the third one is knowing yourself. What kind of a personality are you? Are you an extrovert, outgoing type? Are you shy? Are you you like to keep quiet, or you don't really have much to say? Yeah. What's your way of being? So like speaking about Lumpu Man, so he was very eloquent, very gifted with speech. When he was a young boy, he was very gifted at the Morlam singing. You know, in the Northeast, they have the kind of competitive singing. So like one person, you had to make it up as you go along. You have the band playing the music, and then you have two people kind of dueling songs. And so Lumpu Man, when he was a lad, he was very good at this. And then the people who are singing are making it up as they go along. And they would always try and end the verse. They would sing one verse to the music, and they try and end it with a very difficult rhyme, so that it's very hard to follow along. So you have to think really quick and come up with the right words, and your words have to fit the music, and you also have to figure out a way to make it difficult for the other guy. And so they go back and forth and back and forth until one goes, and they run out of words. So Lumpu Man was really good with speech, very quick, very clever. But his teacher, Lumpu Sao, was very quiet. And he would be, accounts of him teaching Lumpu Man and saying, "Yeah, I can't believe how much your mind thinks. How many words you have. This is, my mind is not like that at all." And there are stories of Lumpu Sao being invited to give a Dhamma talk, and he'd get up on the Dhamma seat and chant Namo Tassa, and then he'd say, "Being good is good. A1. That's it, you know, like a five-word Dhamma talk. And that's okay, that's enough, just yeah, be good. What else is there to say? But then Lumpu Man could get up there and just talk for 2 or 3 hours without even thinking, yeah, without pausing. So are you shy? Are you extrovert? Are you healthy? Are you sick? Are you tired? Are you energetic? What's the shape of the world for you? So to know yourself, to know your character, to know your limitations. So like yesterday, I was giving a talk about fear, about worry. Earlier in the day, I was being interviewed for a magazine. They were asking me the same questions. They'd seen the notice for the talk. So they said, "Can we talk about this for the interview?" And so the person interviewing me said, "You know, my mind ruminates a lot. It thinks all the time, and I worry all the time." And so he said, "What about you? You know, you've got to give a talk at Poh Soi Loh tonight. You know, are you worried about what you've got to say?" And I said, "No, because I never run out of words. I'm a wordy guy." And so over teaching for 35 years, I've never run out of words. So statistically, it's very likely that I will find something to say. So I said, "No, I'm not worried, because I'm not going to run out of things to say." And usually most of the people don't get up and walk out halfway through. Not everybody falls asleep, you know. So he said, "No, it's not a worry." So I know I'm a wordy guy. Sometimes I can be too wordy. So when I was a small child, once my grandmother came from Belgium, and I grew up in England. So every year in the summer, the whole family would go on the boat across the English Channel from England to Belgium. It's about a 3 or 4 hour boat ride. And one time my grandfather said, I will give you sixpence if you stop talking for 5 minutes. I nearly exploded. So it was very, very difficult when I was about 5 years old, 6 years old. So now I try to speak to make my speech useful. So knowing yourself, atanyuta, knowing your own character, your own personality, then a well-rounded person also knows what is the right amount, knowing podi, what's the appropriate quantity, the right amount of speech, the right amount of food, the right amount of attention to give to your different children. So knowing the right amount, matanyuta is the Pali. So like if you're a school teacher, knowing the right amount of time you need to spend with your different students. You know, the ones who are really quick and really self-reliant, you know, okay, well she just needs like hello and then she's off. She doesn't need my attention. But, you know, this other lad, you know, he really needs some help and he's insecure, so I need to give more encouragement. So, you know, this girl needs like 3 seconds, he needs 10 minutes. So knowing the right amount is not just in terms of not eating too much, but it's also in terms of your time, your energy, and the way that you work. So then also knowing the appropriate time for doing things, so that knowing kalanyuta is the next one. Kala, rujak kala tesa, so that knowing the right time, so that if, say, it was 5:45 and you're also sitting here and chatting, yeah, and I climbed up on the Dhamma seat and start to, okay, yeah, I'm ready to start the Dhamma talk. Well, we haven't got sat down and half the people haven't arrived and we haven't done the introduction. So it's not the right time to start speaking. Or if you're all sitting here at 6:00 and I get here at 6:45, you're already here, okay, yeah. Okay, I hope you had a nice time just sitting, waiting for me. That also would not be the right time. So the kalanyuta, knowing the right time for things. Also the time when it's a time to be serious, you know, a time to be quiet, time to crack a joke. That's also, say, what we're bringing awareness to. So all of these things, you can see, it needs sati and sampajanya, mindfulness and clear awareness. Okay, this person's, their husband has just died. This is not the time to be making jokes. Yeah, unless, you know, she makes a joke first, then I can kind of laugh too. But, you know, the person's just sad at the loss of their husband, so this isn't a time to be kind of, hi, how are you? You know, yeah. Talking about the most recent soap opera, you know. It's like, no, that's not the time. Or if it's a time to be kind of giving information, to be kind of academic, or a time to be kind of playful. Like when somebody brings where I've been staying, the family just got a new grandson, is 10 months old, so little boy is brought in each day to kind of see the monk. And so when this little lad comes up, I say, you know, hello, how are you? And, you know, I don't kind of tap the table and start making faces at all of you, not so much anyway. Because for the little boy, that's the time and the appropriate thing to do. So all these aspects are like paying attention. What's the appropriate response to the time, the place, the situation? So then the next quality is, who are you talking to? It's called parisanyuta. Parisa, like Buddha parisat. That comes from the Pali word parisa. So what group are you talking to? So here, this is BIA, so people are Ajahn Buddhadāsa disciples. So if I was in the monastery in the northeast, in the Isan, then maybe I would talk in a slightly different way. If I was talking in English in the Isan, 95% of the people are, because they don't understand English. Most of the villagers and people from Warin, Ubon, not many of them learn much English. So if you have to know the group. Who are you talking to? Is this your employees, or is this your bosses? You know, who are you talking to? Are you conducting the interview, or are you being interviewed? Yeah. Are you asking for a grant for your project, or are you trying to give a grant to somebody? You know, which position are you in? What's the situation? Who are you talking to? So knowing the group, the parisa, and so again, it's attuning to the time, the place, the situation. Because if you're in the role of the teacher, you function in one way. If you're in the role of the student, you function in a different way, right? Probably many of you are ajahns or cruel teachers in your own right. But at the moment, you're in the role of students, so you're kind of with notebooks, you know, taking your... But, you know, if you're in the role of the ajahn and with your classroom in the college and the university, then you're the one up front sort of saying, it's like this, like that. You're doing the explaining. So it's different. It's a different parisa. So then the last of the qualities is pugalanyuta, knowing other people's characters. So if I'm talking to someone, you know, are they 10 months old? Are they 40 years old? Are they European? Are they British? Are they Thai? Are they Sri Lankan? What's their cultural background? What's their educational background? What are they interested in? So assessing the who you're talking to. So the qualities of the people that you're in contact with and working with. So these are all very practical guidelines when the Buddha is saying for a well-rounded person, it's like essentially you can boil it down to pay attention. Pay attention. That you are needing to bring your mind to who you're with, what's the situation, how are things working. So then the second area of qualities is how to function as a group in a harmonious way. So this is very much about sangha life and working harmoniously in a group with other people. And so these qualities, when you look through them, there's a couple of particular teachings that are very, very often referred to in terms of the monastic community and developing wholesome and harmonious relations in the monastery, but it works just the same in the family, in the school, in the college, in the workplace, in the Bangkok traffic. You know, but particularly when you're trying to work together as a unified group. So it's like the people in your university department, or the people in your office, or the people in your family, or the people in your monastery, or your Buddhist center, BIA, you know. So these, and the interesting thing about these qualities, they have a bit of a different tone, where the development of the individual is about having mindfulness, clear comprehension, yoniso manasikara, kind of reflectiveness and paying attention. Then working together as a group, then the emphasis is much more on unselfishness, kind of not attaching to duo don, duo gu, kong gu, kind of being unselfish, being humble, being ready to be humble and not sort of proud or authoritarian, to be grateful, expressing gratitude to others, to your elders and people who helped you, and also compassion. They're much more emotional qualities. So that when you're working together as a group, these are the kind of principles that really need to be brought to mind. So compassion towards others, humility in relationship to others, gratitude towards others, and unselfishness. So like making a point not to put your own concerns first. So that there's two collections of qualities that are often referred to. And again, I'm trying not to make a laundry list, but I will anyway. I see there's many notebooks out. You're free to write these things down. So that these are, the first group is six qualities called the Saraniya Dhammas. Or these are beautiful or wholesome qualities. So this is, first of all, cultivating an attitude of metta chitena, the heart of loving kindness, in your thoughts, your words, and your actions. So if you are trying to function harmoniously in a group, then to have that quality of well-wishing, of kindness towards everyone that you're working with. So, not just in your actions, so you're refraining from attacking other people, or being kind of unkind or rude, in your actions or in your speech, but also in your thoughts. So it's loving kindness in thought, speech, and action. And so that this is a lot about, even if you feel a kind of conflict with someone that you work with, that you really resent how they've treated you, they've been unkind or unfair, then that you're very conscious of those feelings of bearing a grudge or a negative feeling within you. So even if you can't have loving kindness towards that person in your thoughts, like, yeah, but I hate him, at least you can have loving kindness for your own grudge. Kachaimai? You can, when we say loving kindness, doesn't mean we have to like it, but we can say, well, yeah, negativity happens. This is that person hurt my feelings and ow. I'm still carrying it around. Here it is. I don't like it, it's not beautiful, but here it is. So we can have metta for our own negative feelings. Does that make sense? And that's in a way where the meditation and the ability to look at our own mind is very helpful. So that even if we're restraining our action and our speech, and the mind said, well, I can't control my mind, I can't make myself like everyone. I can't make myself be happy to see everyone. It's like, oh no, it's her. Oh, good morning. Yeah, you can't make bitter be sweet, but you can also recognize, well, this is a bitter feeling, and for whatever reason, my heart is still hanging on to that. Okay, so we are having metta, or what I would call radical acceptance, even for that feeling. So then the other three aspects of the Saraniya Dhammas, yeah. One is sharing the things that you have. So that, and the Buddha uses the example for the Sangha. He says, even the food, the alms food you get, if you get some nice kind of delicious thing on the bindabad, you're ready to share it with your friends. So even if you have no possessions, the only possessions you have is the alms food, you're even ready to share that with your friends. So to be ready to offer what you have. So if you want harmony within your office or in BIA or in your family, when you get something good, someone says, so-and-so has just moved out of the corner office and you've got, you know, windows on two sides. You know, would you like this office? And you say, then your first thought might be, oh yeah, great. But then you think, wait a minute, no. Maybe I can share this. So like, well, I've got a kind of, the office I've got already is pretty nice. Why don't you offer this to somebody else that they can appreciate it? So sharing the riches that you have, or the good kind of fortune that you have. And that in Pali is sadharana bhoga. So sharing your bhoga, your wealth, or the good things that you have. So in families, particularly with your sisters, your brothers, then you know there's a strong tendency like, well, that's mine. I want my share. Like, I got the good stuff and tough luck. You know, but that readiness to share what you have is a very profound source of harmony and benefit. When your own sister or your brother, he could have kept it for himself, and he said, here, why don't you have this? Or would you like some? Oh, she does love me. Oh, she does care. Wow. Huh. And we can change the relationship in a good way. So then there is also a sila samanyuta, like the keeping an equal standard of conduct. So like if you are working together or trying to work together in a group, in a sangha or in an office situation, or you're in a department. If you all keep the same standard of virtue, it's much, much easier to be harmonious with each other. There's a mutual respect. If you know that some person is taking office supplies home every day, or that someone, you know, one of your other research fellows is plagiarizing, they're copying half their material, they're kind of cheating on their results or their experiments, or they're borrowing the results of other people without asking and presenting it as their own, then you say, well, I would never do that, so should we keep quiet, or how should we bring that up? Because if people have different standards, someone says, it's okay to rip off the boss, he can afford it. The company is incredibly rich. You know, of course I take things home. Doesn't everybody? Well, no. So when people have a different standard, it always is going to create division. So establishing harmony depends on finding ways to keep a common standard of conduct. And then the last one of the Saranya Dhammas is the Pali for it is ditti samanyuta, like having the same views. So that's a bit more difficult, a bit more challenging. But at least it means having the same kind of basic understanding, the basic attitude of what you're there for. Why are we working for this company? Why are we teaching in this college? Why are we in this monastery? Why do we want BIA to function? What are we here for? And so a common understanding and ways that you can help develop that. So different groups, different people can do this in different ways, but to establish that kind of harmony, to gather together and to ask everyone in the group, what are you here for? Why have you joined this department? Why are you in this Buddhist center? Why are you teaching at this college? What are you here for? And at least you can listen to other people's motivation. Sometimes it's a big surprise, like, oh, this is a career move, is it? I thought we were all here just to end suffering, you know. But at least we can hear each other, and the more that we can appreciate and have understanding of others' motivations, and that we can, say, listen to each other, we can get closer to a unity of view or a unity of purpose. And the more that we're all here for the same reason or similar reasons, the more we'll be able to function harmoniously and beneficially as a group. So at the Abhayagiri Monastery, where I helped to found and to run with Lumpur Opasano for 13, 14 years, every 2 weeks we would have a sharing meeting. And it's a non-business meeting. You're not allowed to discuss business. And it's a feeling meeting. So you talk about how things have been for you. And that was incredibly helpful in establishing a new monastery. And so you talk about what you appreciate like from others, what you regret about your own conduct, and what you resent of others. So where you've been hurt by what someone else has done, what you're glad about by what someone else has done, and what you feel uncomfortable about your own conduct. So gratitudes, resentments, and regrets. I'm not suggesting you have to do this in every hospital or university college or here at BIA, but that way, it was amazing sometimes when you heard just what's been going on in the mind of your fellow monks or novices during that fortnight. Wow, he's really upset about that. I didn't even know that happened. I didn't even notice that. And he's been really upset, and it's been a big thing for him. Or someone said, well, I was really upset, you know, I came into the building and you kind of took one look at me and you scowled, you kind of gave me this really nasty look and you just rushed past me and, you know, if you've got a problem with me, I want you to tell me about it, you know, that why were you so upset? You didn't say anything, you just kind of ran by with this horrible look on your face. And then the other monk would say, oh, I just had to get to the bathroom. You know, I had an emergency. I needed to run to the bathroom, and you were just something in the way, so I'm sorry. It wasn't about you, it was just I had to rush to the loo. So to continue with these lists then, so there's those are the six Saranya Dhammas. Then there's another collection of qualities that the Buddha talked about of how a group can sustain itself in a skillful way over time. And so that this is called the aparani. I always get this one wrong. The aparahanya dhammas. And so this is how the sasana, how the Buddha's
tradition can last for a long time. It's also he said that why the
Vajjayan confederacy was so strong that King Ajatasattu was trying to attack them and couldn't defeat them. And they said, why do I keep attacking them and they keep beating me? And the Buddha said, well, the reason why is because they have very, very strong integration. They have a strong harmony within themselves. And as long as that harmony is there, you'll never beat them because they are very powerful, strong as a community. He outlined these qualities and then also gave the same teachings to the Sangha, saying this is what will help the Sangha to last for a long time. And so these are, firstly, to meet together frequently and in large numbers. So, and Lumpur Cha took these teachings very, very seriously. So this was very much how he established Wat Pah Pong. So that's why Wat Pah Pong has so many meetings, like every year, twice a year, all the heads of the branch monasteries gather. So at Wat Pah Pong just now, we had a meeting with like 580 monks, the heads and vice abbots of many, many branches. In England, we just had the international elders meeting for the global branches with about 125 nuns and monks and novices. So meet together frequently and in large numbers. To gather in harmony, to do your discussions in harmony, and to separate harmoniously, if that's the standard that you observe. To respect the rules, the laws that have been established, and not to change anything without consulting the others. It's kind of obvious, but if you want to, you respect the rules, the agreements that you've made with the group. If you want to change something, you ask first. I know the preference that we have as people is to ask for forgiveness after having done what we want, rather than asking for permission before. But the Buddha would always recommend ask permission first. Ko anuya, which I ko oga, ko kama. Ask permission before. Then to respect the elders, those who have gone before, who have greater experience than yourself. To protect the women and the young and the weak of the community, those who the world sees as vulnerable and are easily harmed in life, to make the effort to protect and support those who are not able to support or protect themselves. And then also how we relate to other religious groups. So to protect the shrines and temples, to look after those in a good way, and to also respect and protect and help other religious people, whether they're your own religion or not, to be open and protective and supportive of them, to not make enemies of other religious groups. So say, for example, right now in the world there's a lot of conflict between the Muslim community and many others. And in Britain they've had some attacks. There was a suicide bomber at the Ariana Grande concert with 22 people were killed, and then the attacks, knife attacks on London Bridge where eight or nine people died in those attacks. Yesterday there was a kind of revenge attack outside a mosque. Somebody drove their vehicle into the crowd of people coming out of the mosque in North London. So there's a lot of tension and conflict, a lot of creation of opposition between the Muslim community and other communities. So I went to an interfaith event at the House of Lords earlier this year that was organized by a Muslim group. And they invited the different religions to have an interfaith gathering in the House of Lords. So it's kind of interesting to go along. And the man who convened it is Lord Sheikh. He's also the head of the Muslim Conservative Association. So there's members of the Conservative Party, like the right-wing people who are in power at the moment. they're sort of conservatives who happen to be Muslims. And so we got friendly. I said, well, if you want to come and visit Amaravati, I'd be very happy to welcome you there. And I was inclined to be very welcoming to them because they actually have a Buddhist woman on their committee. So I thought, well, these have to be, they're not, maybe they're Muslims and they're conservatives, but they're also obviously pretty liberal. If they've got a Sri Lankan woman who's a Buddhist on the committee for the Conservative Muslim Association. So I said, you know, if you'd like to come to Amaravati, we'd be very happy to welcome you there. And so then a couple of days later, they contacted me and said, well, how many people can we bring? You know, so I, up to 100? So I thought it was very important to create an opportunity to get together and to show mutual respect and support, that when there's so much conflict and enemy making in people's minds and creation of the others as a danger, as a threat, as unwanted, as bad, to say, well, no, we're all human beings, we're all trying to live our lives together, so please, if you want to come and visit this monastery, please come. So on July the 1st, we have a busload of conservative Muslims, or Muslim conservatives, coming to Amaravati. So these are the I can never get it right. Aparahaniya dhammas, these seven qualities that lead to the long-lasting, lifespan of the sasana. And so, as I said, Lumbo Cha took these qualities very seriously. So he built his training of the sangha and his community around these things. So there's a great respect for elders. The training of the juniors, like we have this large crowd of young novices, 3-day-old novices. So if these novices were living at Wat Pah Pong, then they would be very much trained. Okay, this is how you look after an ajahn. This is how you accept the yam, the bag of an ajahn. This is how you put it down. This is how you don't put it down. Yeah. This is how you wash the ajahn's bowl. This is how you take the bowl. This is how you put the bowl down. This is how you don't put the bowl down. This is how you wash the bowl. This is how you dry the bowl. And so the connection of the student to the teacher, the juniors to the elders, was like the centerpiece of the Lumpo Cha's training. This quality of respecting the elders and respecting the decisions that the elders have made, even if you think the decision is really stupid. Like, well, that's what we do, because that's what we do. Maybe I can make a suggestion that we can change it, but right now, that's what we do. Okay. There you go. So as a junior, you have an opinion, you have a perspective, but it's not up to you to change things. Or if you do want to change things, you do need to ask the Ajahn first. That's the polite way of doing it. If you do that, then the whole group will last a long time and will really benefit. And so that sense of when you're young, of course, you know best. You know, it's one of those things in a monastery. When you're an 8-precept layman, a pakao, you know, when I have my monastery, I know exactly how it's going to be run. We're going to have this, and I'm never going to allow that, or that ever. So when you're a pakao, you're 100% sure how the monastery should be run. When you're a samanera, you're 80% sure. When you're a navaka monk, when you're in the first 5 years, you're 50% sure. When you're a majjhima monk, when you're between 5 and 10 years, then you're like 20% sure. When you're a tara, you've been a monk for 10 years, you're like 5% sure of how it should be when you have your own monastery. When you're a mahatera and you do have your own monastery and you're the abbot, you realize, mairurun. All of your plans, your ideas, how it should be, how it's going to be, what you're going to have, what you're not going to have, none of it ever works out that way. It's not an ideal, but it's these people at this time, you know, in this group, in this place, that's what I'm working with. So that you're learning to operate with the reality of the situation. So I see the time has already gone past 7 o'clock, so I need to keep things short. But the last area that I wanted to talk about is about leadership. And the Buddha gave a set of 10 qualities the ideal leader of society, a monarch, a queen or a king, a prime minister, a president. These are the qualities that a good leader should have. And so these are, again, if you've got your, take shorthand, so I'll see if I can remember these ones. So they are generosity. And again, one of the interesting things is half of these 10 are about not being violent, not using your authority in a violent way. So it's really striking when you look through this list. Even though you've got the power, you are the president, you're the head of department, you're the head of the corporation, you're the abbot of the monastery, it's like be compassionate, yeah. Be restrained, you know, don't use your power carelessly, but also be courageous. You have to be ready to be brave and make choices, make decisions, but be restrained. So, dana, generosity, sila, being virtuous, then addava, parichaga, which means being ready to self-sacrifice yourself, to give up your own preferences. So parichaga is self-sacrifice. Ajava is to be honest, like to be true to your word. Madhava, to be gentle. Then tapa, which means to have self-control. Then akoda, to be non-reactive, to not be... akoda is gloat. Anger, so akoda is to not be angry or reactive. Akoda, to be kind of ready to listen and to be responsive. Avihingsa, to be non-violent. Don't hit the novices. Yeah. One of our precepts, actually it's only a minor offense to cut the ears off a novice. Did you know that? The police would probably arrest you nowadays, but according to the Vinaya, it's only a dukkata offense to cut a novice's ears off. Not to threaten anybody. So don't threaten the novices. So avihingsa, to be non-violent. Kanti, to be patient. And then avirodhana, to carry out your leadership in accordance with Dhamma. So to practice Dhamma in accordance with Dhamma, to adhere to that quality of righteousness, of truthfulness, of not just speaking Dhamma and acting selfishly or reactively or violently, but being a good model for others. So these are the ideals, and you won't be tested except in your own life. But we, just like a Buddha image, we take these ideals, these qualities, and then if we cling to them, we think, well, I can't remember that, I can't do all of that, you know, I can't be unopinionated or non-reactive, or I can't always be honest, or yeah, I do take this stuff home from the office, and it is a really rich company, and they can afford it, and they're insured anyway. but we take this ideal to give ourselves an example, and just like the Buddha, the Upasada Sutta, if we use these ideals and bring them to mind, then if we try to act in that way, it helps us to touch in our own heart, to be able to use those qualities that already exist within us, to remember we can be non-violent, we can be self-sacrificing, we can look out for others, we can be grateful, we can have gratitude to those who have gone before, rather than just complaining about the old guys who keep telling us that we're doing it wrong. You know, we can instead say, well, thank you, you've been doing this for 30, 40 years. I really appreciate that you've been so patient and so kind to me. So that is something that we can aspire to, so that when we are, looking at these ideal qualities, it's not to make ourselves feel bad or feel inefficient or incapable, but rather to clarify what's the goal, to clarify the possibilities for ourselves and give ourselves a clear direction. Like the Buddha image, he says, yeah, if I could just be like that, everything would be fine. So I will leave things there for in terms of my offerings for all of you. And even though I've said a lot of words, they had all these lists, you know, the seven aspects of the good person, the well-rounded person, the Sapurisa, the six Saranya Dhammas, the seven Aparahaniya Dhammas, the ten Raja Dhammas. That's the ten qualities of a good leader called the ten Raja Dhammas. So it's a lot of Dhammas. But it all comes down to paying attention, being unselfish, and being ready to care for others, to bring the others and the well-being of others into your attention, and to be grateful, to be compassionate, and then things look after themselves. So even though it's lots of lists, many, many words, then it's also it's helpful to understand that living as a good person and helping to contribute to society in an ideal way, it's not about being busy or trying to do all this good stuff, but rather if we pay attention and have an attitude of compassion, kindness, unselfishness, then things look after themselves. Like I was saying about when you get to being a Mahatera and you do have your own monastery, all your plans don't really count. But you pay attention. Who are you with? What's the time, the place, the situation, and what's the right thing to do? So I think I'll end there, and we can have a time to have a bit of a leg stretch for 5 minutes, and then you can come back and ask questions if you need to. Anyone?
Oh, okay. So, I think this will be a very good thing to know, because if you want to be a more likable person or want to be a better person, you should listen to this every day. And I would like to say that when you find you're not happy about something, or you don't have friends, or you've been bullied too far, you can know the best way how to fix this problem. And when you have a major problem that's really making you very angry and upset and sad, you can fix this problem by listening to this. And this can really help your day up. And I think being a monk is good, or being a monk, because it will make us have better concentration skills and listening skills, and it will make you a better person and learn how to try your best and not to give up. If you are a real champion, you should never give up. You should keep going all through miles and miles, and don't say I'm tired, or I can't do it, or we can't do it. You have to say, there is a way, we should do it. Like, listen about the rabbit, the hen and turtle, like the hare gave up in the middle, or almost to the end, because the hare thinks he or she is too good, and then later, he or she said he wants to take a break, and then the tortoise or the turtle tried his hardest, never gave up, and then he beat the hare, and the hare didn't know, and the hare was shocked at the end.
That's right. Well, I'm glad that's what I had to say was appreciated, and I'm sure that your Ajahns have been taking notes. But everything is recorded here, so we have several cameras, and so even if a few things were missed, then it's all there in the data.
Yeah. What is the best way of maybe fixing our day if you have a very bad day or you're upset about something? What's the best way of fixing it?
Well, the best way of working with it is to look at the attitude, the tasanakati, because it was a number of years ago, Lumpo Liam, who was the abbot of Wat Nong Bapong, Ajahn Chah's monastery, he came to visit us in America, Wat Apai Kiri. And one of the lay people asked him this question, said, Lumpo, what was the biggest obstacle or the biggest difficulty that you had in your life as a monk or as a novice? And he said, well, you know, when I was younger, there was a lot of fear, so that was difficult to work with. And then he kind of paused and said, you know, talking in terms of difficulties or problems, that's not really talking in terms of Dhamma, because you know, what we think of as problems, you know, panha or upasak, an obstacle, say they're actually what help us to develop good spiritual qualities. So they help us to raise our game. You know, like if you're in a soccer team, you know, a football team, and you have a match against another local school, and they're kind of, the school is half your size, and they don't have very good sports facilities, and you always beat their team. So that when you go to the match, you're kind of, oh, well, it's going to be easy, and you know, you kind of don't really pay attention, you don't really even tie your boots up very tight, you just don't really care. But then if you're playing against the local division champions, they're like, oh man, oh wow, they're so good. Like when I was at school in England, I was at a little country boarding school with only 350 pupils, and it was in a group of three schools. The other two were in London, and they had like 1,000 pupils. So they had many more people to choose from. So when we would play sports against these other two schools, Westminster School or Emmanuel School, you know, oh wow, this is going to be painful. So you knew, okay, you were playing Emmanuel this weekend, okay, buckle up, you know. And so you'd try extra hard in your training, and you'd be paying really close attention, and with the coach you'd be learning all the different moves and the procedures really well, because you've got to play this big school and they always win pretty much every time. So you raise your game, you improve your skills because of the challenge. So I thought that was really very, very good advice on from Lumpur Liam, that we think of things as like having a difficult person at work, or a family member who hates us, or we have a chronic illness, and oh, if only I didn't have this bad leg, if only I didn't have my brother, yeah, then I could practice. If only I didn't have this the family business that I have to run, then I could practice. But the spirit of the teaching, and what Lumpur Cha would always emphasize, is that if we change the attitude, then what we call difficult or a problem becomes what he would say is like a sharpening stone. You know, when you work, when a knife needs to be sharpened, you rub it against what they call a whetstone, a sharpening stone. He said, what we call our conflicts, so that kind of conflict or friction, you know the word friction, when you rub against something, that is what helps to keep the edge of your wisdom sword really sharp. Because if you wanted a kind of sanuksabai life, kind of easy, comfortable, then your edge can get really blunt because you don't have any challenge. It's like, we're just playing the local team, they're no good, we don't really have to try, we always get 5 goals against them, you know, piece of cake. But if it's like, oh my goodness, Emmanuel or Westminster, even worse, you know, we never beat them, ever. Okay, this time, then you raise your game. You have to work things out, you have to think things through, you have to go against your own fears, your own sense of weakness, and you find you have abilities that are really incredibly helpful. You have just like you're using that friction to give you an edge to try harder. So speaking about fear at this Dhamma talk yesterday, I was reminded of a story I often tell about somebody who was sitting the entrance exam for Oxford and Cambridge. And I often tell this story, but I feel it's very useful to tell. So when you do the Oxford and Cambridge entrance exams, they have two parts. One is the subject that you're studying for. So like if you're doing sciences, it'll be like physics, chemistry, maths. And then the other is the general paper. And the general paper can be about anything. And they're famous for like the kind of broad range of questions that they have. And in the general paper, it's 3 hours long, and you have two questions you have to answer. And and so there might be something really, it's basically to show that you can make an argument and you can present yourself, you can think. And then, so the question might be, there's a suggestion that London could be run on the power of the tides as they come and go up the Thames. Could you do that? Explain. Or it might be, what's wrong with the French? You know, it's like asking a Thai, you know, what's wrong with the Burmese? You know, so it's a kind of trick question. Okay, what are you going to say? And but they want to know how you can think and your own imagination and your own intelligence. So it's not just a matter of repeating facts. So one of the questions on this general paper was, what is bravery? Bravery means like courage. The question, what is bravery? And so you have to pass not just your subject, but you also have to pass the general paper to get in to Oxford or Cambridge. And you get 50% of the marks for each of the two questions. So this one student, or one applicant, she just wrote, for the question, what is bravery? She wrote, this is. Two words which should have taken her an hour and a half to write. Right? Two words, this is. They gave her 10 out of 10. And you never get full marks. But it's like, okay, we want her. This one we want. So that was she raised her game. Like, okay, here I am. I really want to go to Cambridge. And this, everything hinges on this. Okay, here's a challenge. What am I going to do? And then she was brave enough to say this. Simple. Any other questions? Time for one more. I'm not very good at short answers. Yeah. Can you say that louder? Well, it's a good question. So it's very helpful to understand that metta, we think that metta means to try and make ourselves like everything. But that's not what it means. We're not trying to make ourselves like things that are unlikable. Like if our parents are sick, or we've been thrown out of a job, or something like that. So. We have feelings of anger. We're angry with our brother. How can I have metta for that? So metta is the better translation to English is radical acceptance. So it means this belongs. This is part of nature. So that metta is in a way opening the heart to say, here it is. Here's this feeling of sadness. My mum's sick. She's dying. There's a sad feeling, a compassionate feeling. That because I am a child, this is my mother, I care about her, therefore there is this feeling, I have a body, I have a mind. It feels, this feeling has arisen. It's part of nature. It's not that it shouldn't be. So that the metta is, here it is, this belongs. This is part of the natural order. So that you don't like it, it's like you're not trying to make the bitter taste sweet. It's still bitter, but here it is. We have a tongue, it can taste bitter flavors. That's part of the natural order. So when you're praised, it's sweet. When you're criticized, it's bitter. When you succeed, it's sweet. When you fail, it's bitter. That's just a taste. But the heart of metta is, this is what bitterness tastes like. It's like this. This is what sweetness tastes like. It's like this. So that it's much more helpful to understand metta as that radical acceptance. Oftentimes, we mistake metta for kind of having positive thinking about everything. Like, And when we do the traditional practices of metta, like, may I be happy, may all beings be happy, and we kind of go through a list, another laundry list. Maybe this being, that being, that being, that being, may they all be happy. So that's one aspect of metta. But at its root, its essence, is this quality of recognizing that everything is part of nature, in Dhamma Chat. Dhamma Jati is born of the Dhamma, it's part of the natural order. So it belongs. So that when we recognize this feeling of sadness, because often what we do, when we think of metta as positive thinking, if we have, say, anger, like anger about your brother, I'm just making this up. I don't even know if you have a brother, but if you're angry about your brother, say, I shouldn't be angry about my brother, I should have metta for my brother. So I've got to stop being angry and get to the place where there's a me who has metta for my brother. So we try to climb over the anger to get to that place where there's me who has loving kindness. So the anger is kind of shoved aside. But the more we just push it aside and resent it, fear it, we make it stronger. We're just suppressing it, trying to sugar it over, as we would say, which doesn't work. This makes, you add sweetness to bitterness and it makes you kind of want to puke. It's like it doesn't work. So to accept or have metta for the anger is like, okay, well, whether I shouldn't or should or shouldn't have anger for my brother, here it is. This is a human mind, it has feelings, and there are these feelings of anger. Now when you have that radical acceptance, it doesn't mean that you follow it. Acceptance doesn't mean approval. Kachayamai? Just because you say, here it is, doesn't mean that you like it or it's good or you should follow it. If I feel violent towards you, it doesn't mean that I can say, violence belongs, therefore I should hit her. No, violence belongs, but the precepts say, don't hit her. You're a monk, you don't hit people. You know, so that's not what you do. But you might recognize the feeling as natural. So on that basis of metta, you accept the feeling, and then your own wisdom, satipanya, comes in to say, okay, now this is a feeling of anger. Now, if I act on this, this person suffers, that person suffers, everybody loses. So I don't have to hate the anger or fear it, just not act upon it. Like coming to the road, a junction in the road, okay, left goes to Samudprakan. Yeah, right goes to Ganshnaburi. Okay, I want to go to Ganshnaburi. Yeah, go left, don't go right. So it doesn't mean that you have to hate the road to the right or fear it, you just want to go left. If you want to go to Ganshnaburi, you get to the junction, go left. So that in the same way, we recognize, well, this is an angry feeling. If it's followed, it's going to take me to an unpleasant place. I don't want to go to Saraburi, I want to go to Ganshnaburi. So that you are not hating that or fearing it, you're just recognizing that's not a good place to go. So that then when you have the wholesome feelings, like, well, I want to practice loving kindness, I want to be compassionate, then that's the turn that you take. But it's not because you hate or fear the other. So it's a very good question, and in a sense, if we want to develop any kind of peacefulness, any kind of panya, wisdom, it needs to be based on this kind of metta, that we have to be able to accept all the aspects of the body, the mind, and the world around us, whether we like it or don't like it, whether people are behaving in ways that we like or don't like, here it is. That person in your family is really difficult, or that person in the department is cheating on their research paper. Okay, whether you like it or not, that's happening. You have got this illness, whether you like it or not, here it is. So then, rather than saying, well, the world shouldn't be this way, it is this way. And then you work with how the world is, and where you can make a change for the good, then you do. Where you can't make a change, then you leave it alone. When there's something that's harmful, you'll also recognize, well, if I follow that track, it will just lead to more difficulty, so let's not take that turning. Okay?